you may be seated. Don't let this 72 fool you, baby. I still got some juice up in here. It's such a pleasure to be able to spend some time with you. I want you to give all the presenters a tremendous round of applause. Come on, bring it in here. I want you to give yourselves a round of applause to come out and unleash your greatness. I want you to think about where we are now. Yeah. It's a different time in the world. How many of you know things have changed? And I want to say that I feel honored to be in your presence, to be on this great island. Yeah. And seated in this room is greatness. And I'm honored to be in your presence. Give yourselves another round of applause. I want you to think about who you are. I don't know you, but here's what I know about you.
Greatness within you. Got
it. Based upon my own experience, that you have greatness in you. There's a time in my life I did not realize that. Born in an abandoned building on the floor in a poor section of Miami, Florida, in Liberty City, being adopted, being labeled educable, mentally retarded, and put back from the fifth grade to the fourth grade. I sat on the stage because of two women. One gave me life, the other one gave me love. God took me out of my biological mother's womb and placed me in the heart of my adoptive mother.
Yeah.
And she inspired me. She worked for wealthy families on Miami Beach. She cooked for them. She adopted me along with six other children, my twin brother, and then five additional children. We were foster kids first, then we were adopted. She cooked for these families and we ate the food left over for the families that she cooked for. She kept her children, and we wore their hand-me-down clothes. My first dream was to be able to buy groceries for our family. My first dream was to buy clothes that no one else had worn before. And I remember following my mother around on Miami Beach, saying, "Mama, what is it, Leslie? When I become a man, I'm gonna buy you a big, beautiful home just like this." How many of you, if you think about it, someone who has been special to you, someone who impacted your life, how many of you have someone special you'd like to do something for? Raise your hands, please. Thank you. I want you to think about it. I'm going to share with you how you can make that happen. Because not only did I want to buy groceries and clothes for our family, I wanted to buy my mother a beautiful home. And I was able to do that. I'm going to share with you how you can do that as well. But I want to make this clear before I get into my presentation, that the only reason you showed up, the only reason that you invested your money, the only reason that you are giving your time to hear me speak is because you're not cut from the same cloth. We're branches of the same tree. Everything that I'm going to say, you already know. It's already in your heart. If you did not know in your heart of hearts that you can do what I have done plus more, you would not be in this room. So give yourselves a round of applause. Come on, bring it up, bring it up. And so I recognize your greatness, and I'm going to share some things with you. I want you to know that when you have a goal and dream, things don't always happen the way you want them to happen. Am I correct on that?
Yes.
The things that will get in the way of that.
Yeah.
And that's okay too, because those are character building experiences part of it. It's okay. But I want you to think about your dream. I want you to think about a personal dream that you want to achieve. My first personal dream was to take care of my mother. I'm old school. I don't believe a woman should pay bills. I said, "Mama, when I turn 18, you'll never pay another bill. I'll take care of you. I'm gonna sit you down." And when I turned 18, I kept that promise to my mother. I used to cut grass, I worked at Jackson Memorial Hospital as an orderly. I used to work for the Miami Sanitation Department as a garbage collector. I was willing to work 3 and 4 jobs, whatever it took. Let us say together, whatever it takes.
Whatever it takes.
To take care of my mother. And that was my first goal. What is your personal goal? My goals have changed. My mother since passed with a 22-year breast cancer conqueror, passed at 89. And now, my children, I'm working to teach and train them to do what I do and build a business that my grandchildren and my great-grandchildren will take into the future. My favorite book says, "The good man leaves the legacy for his children and his children's children." How many of you want to leave a legacy? Raise your hands. Very good. And so I want you to think about your personal goal and include in there a personal goal of building a legacy. I was watching Steve Harvey. He talked about he went to the hospital. I mentioned this the other day in an interview with a friend of his who was visiting his grandmother in the hospital. And he overheard his friend's grandmother ask his friend, "Do you know your great-grandfather's name?" And the young man said, "No, I don't." And she said, "Because he didn't leave you anything. Had he left you something, you would know his name." I have 3 grandsons, and my goal is for them to know my name. How many of you feel like I feel? Fantastic. Shake someone's hand on your right and left and say, "Let's build a legacy." Do that right now. So let me share something with you where things are. A shift is taking place. People have gotten to the place where they don't want to just work long hours and have a limited amount of pay and don't have money after paying the bills. People, as the young man said to me today, Mr. Positive, they're looking in the mirror and said, "What is it that I can do for me so that I can take care of me and the people that I care about?" The shift is gone. People are not willing, most, and particularly those that are in this room, are not willing to settle for a small life, because you know that you can't fit a big dream into a small life. You're in this room because you've got some big dreams, and you deserve them. Things have changed. The 40-40 plan has gone, where you can go to college and graduate and get a job and work 40 hours a week and retire 40%, which wasn't enough in the first place. Changing, things have changed. You showed up because you're not willing to just survive. You showed up because you know that you're made in the likeness and image of God and been given authority and dominion on everything on the face of the earth, including your personal economy. You showed up because you know you deserve to be wealthy. You deserve to be healthy. You deserve to have positive relationships. You deserve to live a bigger life. You showed up because something in you that says, "I can do more. I can create more. I deserve more." Give me a microphone that's going to be consistent. Help me out, somebody. I should have got an ever-ready battery for this. So, I want you to think about your goals and dreams, your personal goals, your financial goals. What number, what is that? Think of a number. Pull it up. You want to be exact. Your thoughts have magnetic power. I was calling a friend the other day, and the time I was calling him, he was calling me. How many of you have had that experience? Raise your hands. Our thoughts have magnetic power. But most of us don't harness the magnetism in our thoughts because our thoughts are interrupted by what I call weapons of mass distractions. We're distracted with phone calls, emails, tweets, Instagram, and all type of other platforms, phone calls. And so when you're interrupted constantly, your thoughts aren't focused. You can't harness the power and the magnetism in your thoughts. So here's what I'm suggesting that you do. I want you to think right now of your financial freedom number. Pull a number up in your head. That once you do that, that you'll be debt free. Once you do that, you have money to save. Once you do that, you'll be able to contribute to the causes that you believe in. And once you do that, when you earn that amount of money, not only will you be financially free, but if a relative or someone you care about is facing a crisis, you'll be in a position to do more than just pray for them. How many of you would like to have enough money that you can do that? Raise your hand, please. Yes. So you can pray and you can write a check. That's a good thing, am I correct up in here? Yes. And so then I want you to think about your social contribution. Things have changed. People are looking for hope and looking for methods of how they can transform their lives. Before I leave here on Monday, I'm going, and hopefully someone is going to make it possible for me to go into one of the prisons here to talk to some men and let them know that they are better than the things they've been doing. I'm looking forward to come back and conducting the Les Brown Youth Institute and training young people methods and techniques of how they can begin to have a vision of themselves beyond entertainment, beyond athletics, that they can be little league cardiologists and endocrinologists and engineers and architects. They have greatness in them. They're in a great island, a great community that fosters greatness. I'm looking forward to that because the first mind that spoke to me that motivated me was Marcus Garvey. Rise up, be an army. He's the first motivation to speak on the planet if the truth be told. And so I want you to think about what will your social contribution be? I'm in a special place. There's a Russian author, Leo Tolstoy. He said, as I face inevitable death, what in the meaning and purpose of my life that will not be undone or destroyed when I'm gone? And so my goal has been to use my voice to train speakers and life coaches and trainers how to make an impact with an audience, how to transform their lives, to speak for corporations and organizations, to give them hope and methods of how they can carve out a future for themselves, to help to reduce the suicide rate and the incarceration rate and the recidivism rate, and giving young men and women methods and techniques of how to reinvent themselves in this new global economy where we are. How many of you believe, as I do, that we can make a difference in other people's lives? Raise your hands, please. Fantastic. And so that's where I am. But there's a new paradigm. Beyond just working long hours and making a little bit of money, there's a new paradigm that's beyond just surviving. This is a brand new day. 2008 Time Magazine said the computer was the person of the year. Why would they say that? Because for the first time in the history of the world, everyday people have access to information that they never had before and can run a global business from their cell phone. That's a new time. And so as you look at yourself and look at your goals, if you look at your career, if you're working on a job, this is a time that you want to hold yourself to higher standards. This is a time that you want to begin to focus on customer service and make yourself stand out. Provide more service than you get paid for. The day of being average, that time is gone. That this is a time that wherever you are, that you want to develop the habit of doing your best at all times, under all circumstances. Why? Because people form habits, and habits create futures. So wherever you are, how you show up, your performance, wherever you are, your focus, your passion, your higher standards, operating out of the thinking of Henry David Thoreau, who said, do not go where the path may lead, go where there's no path and leave a trail. You're a trailblazer. You set new standards for yourself, not competing with anyone else but yourself, creating the next greatest version of yourself. That's why you showed up today. Because you know you can do more. How many of you know if you had your life to live over again, you could have done more than what you've done thus far? Raise your hands. And we all know that. Why don't we do it? Because we live in a world where we're told more about our limitations rather than our potential.
Sure.
And we've been told no and rejected, and we've been treated less than for most of our lives.
Sure.
And so many of us unconsciously go through life just doing just enough to get by.
Yeah.
life requires more. It demands more. As you think about your goals and your dreams, your personal, your financial goals, and whatever that is, I want you to multiply it 100 times. 100 times. Here's what I know about you, and I don't know you, but based upon my experience, whatever that number you pulled up, I can tell you, you can do 100 times more than that. I had no idea. The first time that I did it, I had no idea. I was shocked. I used to earn $60,000 a year working for the Miami Sanitation Department. I had no idea that I could earn more than an hour and a half than I earned working for a whole year as a garbage collector. I had no idea. There's some things that you can do that eye has not seen, ear has not heard, nor is it in the heart of mankind what God has in store for you when you hold yourself to a higher standard. And this is important, write this down, invest in yourself. Most people invest in things. Warren Buffett, who has billions of dollars in real estate, billions of dollars in the stock market, and in the middle of the recession in the United States, he was asked the question, what's the most important investment you can make? I've come to find out, if you want to be successful, watch poor people and don't do what they do. I remember Ray Mike, he said, the best thing to do for the poor is not be one of them. Oh, behave, whatever. And if you want to be successful, watch wealthy people and do what they do. Warren Buffett, he invested in himself, graduated from Harvard. He invested in a communications course. He said, once you open your mouth, you tell the world who you are. And that's real. And so you want to invest in yourself. Why? Because you are your most valuable commodity. That's what I did. And my friends and family members, they laughed at me when I was investing in myself. I want you to write this down, The Road to Your Best Self by Mike Williams. The Road to Your Best Self. I wrote the foreword for that. He's been my mentor for 48 years. The Road to Your Best Self. There are places that book will take you within yourself that you can't go by yourself. So you want to invest in yourself. You want to get a coach, get a mentor. Why? Because you can't see the picture when you're in the frame.
True.
Serena Williams is the greatest tennis player of all time, and she has a coach. She has a coach. People who are mastering what they do, Michael Jordan, when he played basketball, never won a championship without Phil Jackson. People who are at the top of their game, they have coaches. Because you can't see the picture when you're in the frame. And as I said, everything I'm saying now, you already know it. You invested in yourself being here. You know that. But there are a lot of people who should be here who would not come, but let a concert come. And they will come and show up. Why? Because they have an entertainment consciousness. Write this down. You have an achievement-driven mindset. Those are the people that are going to make it in this era of the late Peter Drucker called the era of the three C's: accelerated change, overwhelming complexity, and tremendous competition. You drive around the island, you hear people have music pumping loud coming out of their car, look at them, and just be thankful that you have a higher level of consciousness. You can listen to music, things that didn't entertain you, but you can listen to things that can empower you. My mind was drilled. I was shining Mr. Sudersky's shoes. My mother worked for this wealthy man, and he was listening to motivational messages every day. And I loved being in his office in the morning. That's when he started that. I heard on one of those recordings that the first thing you listen to the first 20 minutes when you get up in the morning controls the spirit of your day. And even though I was labeled educable mental retarded when I was in the fifth grade and put back from the fifth grade to the fourth grade and failed again when I was in the eighth grade, as I was listening to those recordings, it began to restructure my thinking. Some of you here, I met people here said, Les, I listened to you first thing in the morning. I listened to you on YouTube and you have changed my life. How many of you had that experience?
Yeah.
Raise your hands. Yes. And so I want you to know that if you did not know in your heart of hearts that you can do what I've done plus more, you wouldn't be here. I remember the first time I was amazed. Have you ever done something where you said, I can't believe that I'm doing this? Raise your hands, you know, blah, blah. First time I earned $200, now mind you, the average person will earn $240,000 U.S. in their lifetime. The first time I earned $260,000 in an hour and a half, I was shocked. Trust me on this. A good dog, a healthy hog, and a few crabs and some punk salad, you can make it through the winter in Jamaica with $260,000 U.S. Am I correct on that? People say money won't make you happy, but everybody want to find out for themselves. And let me tell you something, fellas, even if you're homeless as I am, you got some money, women will find something cute on you. I heard somebody backstage say Les Brown has earlobes like Denzel Washington. He's got eyelashes like Tom Cruise. Whatever, behave. I'm gonna get you at all. I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I got interest. So I want you to know, listen, you were born to be rich. I only attract millionaires or millionaires in training. Give yourself a round of applause. Say it's possible.
It's possible.
Say it again like you mean it. It's possible.
It's possible.
And I want you to hold the vision of that. See, Carl and Marsha, I want you to know, and John, that as you look at your goals and dreams, here's what we know, Danny. All of us have dreams, but only 1% of people make their dreams become a reality. So here's something I'm going to save you some time on. Don't ask yourself how you're going to do it. I made that mistake. I could have been speaking 14 years longer. But for 14 years, my heart said, I can do that. How many of you like to change lives? Raise your hands, please. My heart said, I can do that. But what happened was, when I left the event, my mind asked, how will you do that? You don't have a college education. How will you do that? You were labeled educable, mentally retarded, put back from the fifth grade to the fourth grade, fell again in the eighth grade. How will you do that? You never worked for a major corporation. How do you think you're going to build a level of credibility having the complexion of rejection that somebody's going to reach over people with a complexion of connection and hire you? How many ever thought about something you wanted to do and you're being logical and practical and realistic kicked in and you stop yourself? Raise your hands. There's an African proverb that says, if there's no enemy within,
the enemy outside can do us no harm.
The fault, dear brothers, is not in our stars, but in ourselves that we are underlings. The things I should do, I don't do, and the things I shouldn't do, I do. And so as you look at your goals and dreams, one of the most important things to do is maintain a spirit of optimism that you can make this happen in spite of the failures. You can make this happen in spite of the defeats. You can make this happen in spite of the rejection. You can make this happen in spite of the setbacks. Willie Jolly said, a setback is a setup for a comeback. You have comeback power. Yeah. I've got a saying, the life knocks you down, try and land on your back, because if you can look up, you can get up. You can get back up again. Doesn't matter how many times you get knocked down. What matters is how many times you get back up. And you're going to get knocked down. Things are going to happen to you. You can't anticipate. My oldest son, Calvin, is in the hospital now. And then my youngest son. It happens to everybody. My favorite book says, think it not strange if you face the fiery furnaces of this world. You will, not you might. You will have tribulations. How many of you know that's real? But repeat after me, please. It has not come to stay. It has come to pass. Once you know that, if you're going through some stuff right now, if you're going through a storm like I am right now, it has not come to stay. It has come to pass. Something else Winston Churchill said, if you're going through hell, don't stop. Keep moving. Keep moving. Don't stop and tell everybody. 80% don't care. And 20% glad is you. Not them. So the key is to believe in spite of the setbacks, in spite of the failures, to be patient and persistent and optimistic that it's possible that you can snatch victory from the jaws of defeat. Here's something else, write this down. You will fail your way to success. You're gonna fail your way to success. See, 86% of the people who are involved in sales, when they get a rejection, they stop. 86% of people, when they hear a no, they experience a rejection, they stop. No. No. That's not the name of the game. You will fail your way to success. 8 out of 10 millionaires have been financially bankrupt. Walt Disney filed bankruptcy 7 times and had 2 nervous breakdowns. Repeat after me, please. Lord, help me to hold out. Everybody together. Lord, help me to hold out.
Lord, help me to hold out.
Until my change comes.
Until that change comes.
Check someone's hand on your right and left and say, your change is coming.
Your change is coming.
It's coming. In fact, it's right here, right now. As you look at your goals and dreams, write this down. It's necessary to write those goals down and get a visual picture of the goal so you can see it on a regular basis and write it as if it already is. I wanted to buy my mother a home. I wrote the goal. I give thanks that I have purchased a home for my mother that I desire. I took a picture of it. Hadn't even made the first down payment. Didn't even have a contract. But I saw the house, I knew my mother would love it. I took a picture of it, and I wrote, I give thanks that I purchased this home for my mother, debt-free, and purchased all the furniture. Then I drove my mother in that area of North Miami Beach, and she said, Leslie, slow down. I said, what is it, Mama? She said, I love that house there. If I lived in something like that, I'd feel like Mrs. Rockefeller. She was a very wealthy lady. I said, you really like that? She said, yes, Leslie. Wow. We just stood there and watched it for a moment, got out of the car, and she was marveling at the lawn, how well sculptured it was, the waterfall, how huge this house was, this home, this mansion. And I made up my mind I was going to get it. When you have a golden dream, write this down. Commit yourself. Don't ask how you're going to do it. How is none of your business? Lean out unto thine own understanding and all thy ways and acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path. That's none of your business. That's God's business. Write it down. As if. Like you own it right now. That promotion, your business, more money, a better relationship, a healing. Every year for 21 years, I said, I give thanks, I'm healed. Go back to the doctor, the instruments are saying something contrary to that. That's none of my business. I'm still claiming it because healing takes first place in the spirit and then in the physical. So I'm not discouraged. I'm still standing and believing that this is a yes last year because 7 is my lucky number. This is 21 years I've been kicking cancer's butt. So claim what you want. Say, I'm healed. Let us say together, I'm healed.
I'm healed.
In my mind.
In my body.
In my spirit.
In my emotions.
I'm healed.
I'm healed.
From head to toe.
From head to toe.
And I give thanks.
And I give thanks.
Thou shall decree a thing and it shall be established. Thank you. We're declaring it. We have the faith to call forth those things that be not as though they were. You've got to take a stand in your life in spite of. You've got to take a stand in life in spite of the medical instruments. You've got to take a stand in life that you're God's millionaire even if you don't have 2 dimes to rub together. You've got to take a stand in life. Therefore, take unto you the whole armor, the armor of faith, and knowing that this too shall pass, and I was born to be rich, healthy, and successful. Give yourselves a round of applause. goes down in the affirmative as if, and that you read them on a regular basis. That you write down and you break down action steps that you must take before going to sleep at night. Write down 7 things that you want to achieve the next day that would lead you in the direction of your goal. So that when you wake up tomorrow morning, you have an agenda. See, most people, the average person, is just trying to get through the day. You want to have an agenda for your day. I have an agenda for my life in becoming a speaker. I invested in myself. I gave myself a quota of memorizing a minimum of 3 quotes a day. I gave myself a commitment to read 30 to 40 pages of something positive every day. I heard a study that said the average person reads 1 book a year. But if you, and keep in mind, knowledge is the new currency, if you read 1 book a month, when the average person reads 1 book a year, in 5 years, the average person would have read 5 books, you would have read 60 books, that will make you an expert. I'm an animal. I was hungry to be successful. I was hungry to buy my mother a home. I was hungry to be able to be my own boss and take care of myself. I was hungry. And so I disciplined myself to read 2 to 3 books a month. What I'm suggesting to you, if you just do one, just 30 to 40 pages every day, 7 days a week, is your ritual in the area that you have interest in. I can tell you, in a very short time, in 5 years, you will be an expert. When I worked the WVKL radio station in Columbus, Ohio, the other disc jockeys used to laugh at me. Write this down. Whatever you're doing, you're working on a job, give it your best. At all times, under all circumstances. They couldn't understand. I was morning personality. I knew how to edit commercials and produce commercials. I was a production director. I learned how to become the program director. I learned how to do editorials. I trained myself on how to do a talk show. Why? Write this down. You work on a job, make yourself indispensable. Make yourself indispensable. Provide more service and you get paid for. Why? You want the habit of holding yourself to higher standards. Negative behavior is addictive. Warren Buffett said, negative thoughts and negative habits are too light to be felt until they're too heavy to be broken. You want to get in the habit of making the right choices, doing the right things, holding yourself to a higher standard, living from a place of integrity, providing the best service in terms of quantity and quality at all times, under all circumstances. Because that represents who you are. Because that's the way in which you take your standing position in life. They used to laugh at me, but they don't laugh now. They see what I'm doing? I've spoken in over 51 countries. They're not laughing now. Earned more in 1 hour because I held myself to a higher standard than the average American will earn working for a minimum of 2 years. They're not laughing now. When I speak internationally, the average American will have to work for 5 years to earn what I earn. I'm telling you what I know. You're not here by accident. This is the time you have to push yourself. Let us say it together, push!
Push!
You got to challenge yourself today. Don't look to the right and don't look to the left. Don't worry about what people think about you. What they think about you is none of your business. You just focus. Keep our eyes single, my whole body will be full of light, of understanding. You focus and do what you're supposed to do to the best of your ability. And not only do you want to write your goals down and have some visual that you can see that's programming your subconscious mind where 95% of your behavior comes from, and have action steps, a minimum of 7 that you will write at night and you will engage in the next day to move you in the direction of your goal and dream, whatever that might be. But it's necessary that you detoxify your life. Write this down. Detoxify your life. Many people want to achieve their goals, because they have too many toxic, negative, energy-draining people in their lives. There's a new term in psychiatry called relational illness. There's some people that can make you sick. I'll tell you what I know. Les, can you change them? No. It's a full-time job changing yourself. And I love to say there's some people so negative they can walk into a dark room and begin to develop. Don't behave, whatever. No. Absolutely not. I know a young lady, she was dating a guy, and he was called Dog. And Dog got her pregnant and left her. She was crying. I said, help me understand. What's the boyfriend name? Dog. Why do you think they call him Dog? This is beautiful. You know, Stevie Wonder can see what this is. You know, my angel said, they walk like a duck, talk like a duck, walk like a duck, walk like a duck. So I asked him, I said, man, why do you call him Dog? He said, I'm a low down dirty dude. I said, I got you. Dog, come on. Guy said to me, hey, what's happening, my dog? Said, no, brother, my name is Les Brown. I'm not your dog. I spoke in a prison recently. I shot them. They came in the room, and what reminded me of, I saw a taxi driver yesterday. He got out of the car for something, and he had his pants sagged. So, in this prison, guys came in and pants sagged below their butt. I said, look, I'm an old man. So what y'all call that? How you wear your pants? They said, sagging, old man. I said, sagging? I said, spell it for me. They said, S-A-G-G-I-N. I said, yeah. I was walking back and forth. Dipping a little bit, you understand? I said, spell it for me again. S-A-G-G-A-N. Then I quoted Dr. Carter G. Woodson. He said, if you can determine what a man shall think, you never have to concern yourself with what he will do. He said, if you can make a man feel inferior, you never have to compel him to seek an inferior status, for he will seek it himself. And if you can make a man feel justly an outcast, you never have to order him to go to the back door. He'll go without being told. And if there's no door, his very nature will demand one. I said, spell it again for the old man. How y'all spell it? They said, S-A-G-G-I-N. I said, spell it backwards. Wow. Wow. Ain't so funny now. Rubber. I got through, they got so motivated, they want to leave with me. I said, oh, you can't go with me. Get to the crowd. You get to the town, go to the crowd. I hate to go there, whatever. Here's something else. Be mindful of your words. You're in this room with me. You're at a high level of consciousness. You're not given the luxury to speak like everybody else. In the beginning with the word is God. The words govern your life. Never use words or entertain conversations. Somebody call you, scream these four things. Let make sure the words you speak to yourself and the words that you listen to, make sure, number one, they're positive. If I look at my phone in person, it's not known to be a positive person. I'm not going to take the call. I don't care if it's my twin brother. Number two, is it purposeful? Is it in the direction of where I'm going? I'm not interested in the interruptions that will throw me off course. Is it positive? Is it purposeful? Next thing is it productive? Is that a conversation you need to have at that point in time? When is your money-making time? You gotta carve out some time, and during that time, you only take calls that will make it profitable for you to take that call. to entertain that conversation. This person calling with some ideas. We only grow through projects and people. Write that down. That's how we grow, through projects and people. So is it positive? Is it purposeful? Is it productive? If it's not productive, I don't need to entertain that conversation. You're going to have some stuff you're going to have to deal with. You need some caring thinking. In order to make it, one, it's mindset transformation. How people live their lives is a result of the story they believe about themselves. I'm interrupting your story. Two, the next thing is your skill set, your ability to communicate. It gives you access. That's why Warren Buffett spent money on the Dale Carnegie course. They have a booth here. To improve his communication skills. Once you open your mouth, you tell the world who you are. Write this down. Put your money where your mouth is. Why is that important, Les? Well, here's the new paradigm. Today, if you can communicate, you can create a movement. If you can communicate, you can earn millions of dollars in the comfort of your home on your couch. And we teach you how to do that, to create non-performance income and have a global customer base. If you know how to communicate, if you know how to bring your personality and your passion to that camera. And we teach you how to do that, a new paradigm. It's a brand new day. That's why Time Magazine said the computer was the person of the year, because now it's a level playing field. When you have access to information and new methods in how you can create income, it's all about your willingness to say, it's me. Write this down. Take responsibility for your life. Take responsibility for the kind of life that you want to lead. What is it you want? Take the time, get quiet, and ask yourself. Turn off the computer, turn off the television, turn off the phone, and get quiet. God asked Adam, Adam, where art thou? Didn't ask because he didn't know. God is omniscient, all-knowing, all-knowledge. Adam, where are you? Didn't ask because he didn't know where he was. God is omnipresent, evenly present, everywhere at the same time. Write this down. Life is a question. How you live your life is the answer. Life is a question. Where are you? Given your talents, abilities, and skills, where are you? Given the vision and dream you have for yourself and your family and for your country, where are you? Given all of the blessings that God has bestowed upon you, made in his likeness and image, and given authority and dominion over everything on the face of the earth, where are you? When I had to answer that question, I had to face the reality that I had talked. I had faced the reality I was operating far below my potential. I had to face the reality at that time I was behind on my bills and my dream. I had to look at myself and be brutally honest that I had not lived up to my own expectations. Have you ever gotten so upset with yourself that you wanted to kick your own behind? Say, what were you thinking? Why did you do that? I want to kick my own butt! I woke up and went, I'm 72. My God. I used to think people in their 40s were old. Now I feel like I was a waiter at the Lord's Supper. 72, who does that?
I got issues.
George Bernard Shaw said that people make it in life, they look around for the circumstances that they want. And if they can't find them, they create them. You have creative power. You have the ability to do more. You got to challenge yourself. Write this down. Raise the bar on yourself. Raise the bar. Get some goals beyond your comfort zone. Something you know that will challenge you. Something you know that will stretch you. Why? Because in order to do something you've never done, you've got to become someone you've never been. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You've got to die to who you are now to give birth to who you must become. It's possible. It's necessary. It's a process. It's you. And it's hard. How many of you know it's hard? Raise your hands. Shake someone's hand on your right and left and say, I can do hard. Do that right now. It's hard. Easy is not an option. It's hard when people are toxic and negative all around you. It's hard when family members and friends who can help you won't. It's hard when people are attacking you and degrading you and demeaning you. It's hard when you're in an environment where you're not appreciated and valued and you're tolerated rather than celebrated. It's hard to keep your spirits up. It's hard to focus your mind and be on purpose when you have pain in your body. Or a doctor looks at you and says three words that no one wants to hear. You have cancer. That's what happened to me. You have cancer, Mrs. Brown. Three words, the most feared word in seven different languages. Can you give me a second opinion? Yes, and you're homely too. Oh, behave. I'm sorry. That was rough. That's rough. Mrs. Brown, why are you smiling? What do you mean? I just told you you have cancer and it's metastasized to seven areas of your body. Why are you smiling? Are you in denial? No. Seven, doctor, is my lucky number. Did I tell you? I'm one of seven children. I was born on February 17th. My phone number is 702. My address is 2737. Did I tell you seven is my lucky number? Joshua marched around the walls of Jericho seven times. Naaman dipped himself in the river Jordan seven times. Did I tell you, Doc? Seven is my lucky number. That means that cancer's getting the hell beat out of it. Things are gonna happen to you.
Yeah.
That you won't see coming. Wants to come. The greater is he that is in you than he that's in the world. Mr. Positive will write, you're more than a conqueror. You're different. And you gotta know that. And everybody around you are trying to pull you in, trying to distract you. And people don't know the truth about you. You got to stand strong in yourself and know the truth about yourself. You got to encourage yourself. Be brave if you have a positive, nurturing, empowering environment. Be brave if you had all your bills were paid and you had money in the bank. I remember touring President Donald Trump. We're doing a program called Millionaires in Training. He was lamenting his father only gave him $14 million. If somebody gave me $14 million, that would be my dream. How many of you know if somebody gave you $14 million for your dream, you got a good shot at making it happen? My mama gave us two pieces of sugar cakes. That's encouraging. Don't miss that. All right. It's hard. Write this down. Put it where you can see it. If you do what is easy, give yourself a pass. Come up with excuses. Focus on the problems. If you do what is easy, your life will be hard. But if you do what is hard, your life will be easier. The baby said, I can do that. Here's something else. It's worth it. Whatever the sacrifice that you have to make, and all dreams have to sacrifice, is worth it. The reporter asked me the other day in an interview, what's the greatest accomplishment you've made? I said, when my children met with me and said, Daddy, we were angry at you. We knew that you knew that we were angry. For all the special occasions that you missed, But we did not know the sacrifice of what it took to make a dream happen. We did not know why you were so determined that when we went to college, we go to the college of our choice and graduate without any student loans hanging over our heads. We did not know what it took to do what you have done. And we're proud of you. And we love you very much. That was my greatest achievement. And see Matthew come up here. How many of you have children? Raise your hands, please. For those of you here, I want Patrick and my son, John Leslie, and my daughter, Ona, and Serena. We're going to come back. I have five boys and five girls. I'm a real Jamaican. Can you feel a brother up my head? And I'm flipping the crazy ones. I want the real crazy ones. I got one that's caused me more problems than all the rest of my kids together. I was looking at him the other day and said, boy, you about to make me lose my mind. Up in here, up in here. You about to make me act a fool. Up in here, up in here. Come on, you bipolar. I'm about to snap that bipolar out of you. I'm gonna get an orange jumpsuit for you, boy. How many of you know they can drive you crazy if you have a great man for me? I'm telling you, I couldn't wait to get here. I was at the airport, some little dudes outside smoking some marijuana. I just stood next to them and just started breathing deeply. Sorry, I'm just playing. I'm a baby Christian. I'm just saying that, Lord. Okay, I'm gonna be good. All right. It's worth it. Write down five reasons of why you're not gonna give up on your golden dream. Five reasons when others throw in the towel. Five reasons when you're rejected again and again. Five reasons when you run out of money and out of support and you're the only one standing. Five reasons that you will be empowered and be optimistic in spite of and snatch victory from the jaws of defeat. What are those five reasons? I promised my mother, Mama, I'm going to take care of you. I'm going to take care of you. You never pay another bill. I'm going to sit you down. Mama, if anything happened to you, you can count on me. I was state legislator. My sister called me and said, Leslie, are you sitting down? No, what's going on with Mama? Mama has breast cancer. I'm coming now. No, you don't have to. We found a good nursing home. Listen to me. No, don't touch her. I left that same day. Just got elected to the Ohio legislature. Passed 14 bills my first term. This was my third term. I had a problem. How can one woman raise seven children who couldn't take care of themselves, but seven grown people can't take care of one woman? No, it ain't going down like that. Right. And when I rung the doorbell, a friend of hers named Miss Mildred was there. And she said, Mamie, Leslie's here. And I heard my mother say, I knew he would come. Wow. I knew he would come. How many of you have somebody in your life that you want them to know that if anything happened, you're going to show up? Raise your hand. Yes. So those reasons. Nietzsche said, if you know the why for living, you can endure almost anyhow. Those reasons will keep you strong. When life gets you on the blind side, drop you to your knees, you're stronger than you give yourself credit for being. I'm telling you what I know. I remember when I had this event and I needed some products. A lady told me, Mr. Brown, we want you to speak at our convention and we need you to bring a lot of products and people love you and they want to purchase your products. I called the guy who duplicated my products. He said, that order is too big. You don't have that kind of credit. I said, can you extend it to me? I said, I know I can sell all my product there. And he said, yes, okay. Are you sure? I said, I give you my word. And so the lady told me she's going to send the contract out. And I said, thank you very much. 3 weeks pass, no contract. Man duplicated the products, sent me the big invoice, and said, tell me where to send it. So something said, call. I called, hi, this is Les Farm calling, yes. May I speak to Carolyn Mackey, please? I'm sorry, Carolyn died. She died? Yes, sir. Did she say anything about you? No, sir, she didn't. Is there an order for Les Brown to be your speaker at your next convention? We don't have any record of that. You don't have any record of that? No, sir, we don't. Do you know when the arrangements are? Yes. I flew to Chicago to make sure it was her. I went and I saw her, I was crying more than the family. One white gentleman put his arm around my shoulder, he must have thought I was the black sheep of the family. He took me over and sent me with her family, I was the only black one there. I cried so hard my eyes as red as two cherries in a glass of butter. And when they close the casket, I start speaking in tongues. I went to my room and I had some tapes in my room. And they said, you want to listen to us, motivator?
Problem do you have? I said, just touch my head.
She said, well, what's your problem? I need to have direct contact. I said, I got prostate cancer. She said, touch it, Jesus. Here's something else. As you look at your goals and dreams, stuff's gonna happen. Before an airplane takes off, they say, fasten your seatbelt, because you're going to experience some turbulence before you reach a comfortable altitude. When you're building a business, fasten your mental and emotional and spiritual seatbelt. Be patient, be persistent, and be optimistic. Because there are people who say, oh, you can count on me, and they won't be there. You're going to have some moments. You're going to have a drought when you can't make a sale. You can't pay anybody to buy something from you. It's some tough times. You might say, oh, yeah. He's about to speak in tongues over there. I'm just my brother on board. It's during that time that you got to say, Lord, help me to hold out. Write this down. No matter how bad it is or how bad it gets, I'm going to make it. Write it down. And say it to yourself over and over again. Sometimes you got to encourage yourself. No matter how bad it is or how bad it gets, I'm going to make it. I was in a wheelchair from sciatica pain and cancer pain in my shoulder, the scapular area. And I was speaking from a wheelchair. I remember Patrick was rolling me through the airport and I had my head down. People saw the back of my head and said, hello, Les Brown. I said, how did they recognize me? I was embarrassed. I couldn't hold up my body weight. My children had to help me in and out of the truck, had to help bathe me. I was like their child, in pain constantly. And I had to confirm, affirm to myself over and over again, no matter how bad it is or how bad it gets, I'm going to make it. And I can tell you, those times that I went through, I'm glad I didn't give up. My mother didn't give up when I had diphtheria. And doctors used to come to the house, and Dr. Johnson came and said, Mayman, you can give this boy these drops every 3 hours. And I remember my mama thought I was asleep about 2 o'clock in the morning, and she was praying over me. Diphtheria is the congestion of your lungs. And she's saying, Lord, take it off my son and give it to me. I'm strong. Don't take my baby from me. One of my friends and grands, other kids wouldn't play with us because they thought diphtheria was contagious. And he died. My mama prayed, dear God, this is my boy. She put her hand over my mouth, over my throat, over my lungs. She wrapped me in some Palmer Christian leaves. And asked this. My boy, please. And as I heard her voice, I knew I was going to get better. And the next morning I was able to talk. My mama was just able to whisper. And she said, thank you, Jesus. Thank you. I know there are times when you go through stuff. Times you get stuck, if you have illness in your body, sometimes you get tired. Just get tired of fighting. Yeah. I mean, you know what I'm talking about. just seem like one blow coming after the other. Mother was diagnosed with breast cancer. The person I love wanted a divorce. My best friend was waiting on a liver transplant and died. And I was diagnosed with prostate cancer. Bills were accumulating. And I remember my son, John Wesley, said, "Daddy, are you going to die?" I said, "All of us want to die sometime." He said, "But are you going to die now?" I said, "Why are you asking me that?" "Because you're in the room. And I don't hear anything. I don't hear you playing anything. I don't see you reading your books. You stopped something happening. When your grandmother died, John Wesley, it took something out of me. It took something out of me." "I know, but what would grandmama want you to do now? Be strong. Can you do that, Daddy? Can you be strong?" I said, "I'm trying to. I'm disconnected from myself. I can't explain it. I can't explain it. Boo's gone. Mama's gone. I can't explain it, John Wesley." He said, "Don't try and explain it. What did Grandma do when she went through the tough job? She kept moving." He said, "Then let the violence up. Open the door. Come out of the room. Let's go for a walk." She never stopped. "Keep moving, Daddy. Keep moving. If you have to hold one hand on my shoulder, you can't afford to stop. You right there." I said, "I am." "And keep moving." And I walked myself out of that dark place. I don't know what you're going through. Here's what I know: my son was right. Out of the mouths of babes. Keep moving. Keep moving. You don't have the luxury of sitting around looking at television and playing video games. Keep moving. Keep moving. You don't have the luxury of engaging in negative conversation about the problem. You've got to be focused on making some money and coming up with a solution. Keep moving. Keep moving. You can't be like everybody else. You are uncommon." I choose not to be a common man. It's my right to be uncommon if I can. I seek opportunity, not security. I do not wish to be a kept citizen, humbled and dulled by having the state look after me. I want to take the calculated risk, to dream and to build, to fail and to succeed. I refuse to live from hand to mouth. I prefer the challenges of life to the guaranteed existence, the thrill of fulfillment to the still calm of utopia. I will never cower before any master, nor bend to any threat. It's my heritage to stand erect, proud and unafraid, to face the world boldly and say, "Yes, I have done. You are here because you are uncommon." Give yourselves a round of applause. Keep moving. Keep moving. Keep moving. Keep moving. Keep moving. I love the story of Dr. Howard Thurman, who was a mentor to Dr. Martin Luther King. He wrote "Deepest of Hunger," the voice of the genuine. "After I received 238 radiation seed implants and my PSA, which stands for prostate specific antigen, continued to rise, 1 to 4 is normal. That time is 2,400. And I was reading his words. Dr. Thurman said, "The ideal situation for a man or woman to die is have family members praying with them as they cross over." He said, "But imagine, if you will, being on your deathbed and standing around your bed, the ghost of the dreams, the ideas, the abilities given to you by life, and you, for whatever reason, you never pursued those dreams, you never acted on those ideas, you never used those talents, you never developed your gift. And there they are standing around your bed looking at you with large angry eyes, saying, 'We came to you, and only you could have given us life. And now we must die with you forever. And the question is, if you die today, what dreams, what abilities, what talents, what skills, what book, what voice, what leadership would die with you? Great preacher, mentor, orator Miles Monroe out of Nassau, Bahamas, who died in a plane crash. Miles said, the wealthiest place on the planet is not in the Four East where there's oil in the ground. It's not in South Africa where the diamond mine. Well, Miles said, the wealthiest place on the planet is the cemetery. There you'll find potential never realized. There you'll find dreams never pursued. There you'll find people operating being average. They had greatness in them. There you'll find books never written, inventions never made, ideas never pursued. Everybody repeat after me, please. Live full.
Live full.
Everybody together. Live full.
Live full.
Dying.
Dying.
Take someone's hand on your right and left and say, I'm dying in. Look at it. And you've met a little young man named Dane. 15 years old. How you doing? How you, young man? I'm fine. I'm the future prime minister of the Bahamas. How old are you? 15. He has a vision for himself. Some of the adults won't laugh, but there were others who stuck their chests out with pride. And he didn't see himself as a future rapper or athlete, and there's nothing wrong with those. But he saw himself as a leader, making history, making a difference, making an impact. All of us have the ability to do that. You were created on purpose, with a purpose, in you. And only you can manifest and see that that purpose that you were chosen for out of 400 million sperm will manifest. You're the only channel, the only vessel that will come through. No one's going to give my speech. This has been given to me. But you've got a voice. There's something in you. And I believe you showed up here because you know that you can do more. I believe that you showed up here because you know in your heart of hearts you have greatness in you. I believe you showed up here because you want to live a bigger life and that you know that you can. And there's nothing to stop you but you. In 1961, when then President John F. Kennedy was faced with a challenge, he met his cabinet, brought them together. He asked a question. What will it take for us to beat the Russians to the moon? And everybody thought about it. They didn't have the technology. Computers did not exist. They thought about it. They thought they were going to be there for months. They looked at Wernher von Braun, a brilliant German scientist. Vernon, come on, what will it take for us to beat the Russians to the moon? When I was a kid, you would illustrate someone not being able to do something, saying you have as much chance of doing that as a man going to the moon, because it was considered impossible. And this German scientist spoke five words. The president paused and looked around the room and called a news conference a few days later and said, we're going to the moon in 10 years. He risked global embarrassment of the United States. What were those five words? As you think about your personal goals, what were those five words? As you think about your financial goals, what were those five words? As you think about your social contribution, what were those five words? He said, the will to do it. Let us say together, the will to do it.
The will to do it.
What will it take for you to advance your production. Be more productive. Increase your sales. Let us say it together. The will to do it. Everybody together.
The will to do it.
What will it take for you to earn more money, to control your personal economy, to have money to save and be able to contribute to causes you believe in and to take care of people that you love? Let us say it together.
The will to do it.
What will it take for you to begin to understand, in spite of what somebody might say, with a stethoscope around their neck and a white jacket, and say that you're terminally ill, and you know that doctors should never tell someone they're terminally ill? What they should say is that my ability to help you has terminated. And now you need to know you can cure yourself and make some other choices because you have what? What will it take for you to build meaningful relationships, healthy relationships, create collaborative, achievement, supportive relationships that will empower you to create the next greatest version of yourself? The will to do it. Shake someone's hand on your right and left and say, I have the will. How many of you have the will? Raise your hands, please.
Very good. That's why you showed up.
Yep.
It's in you already.
Yep.
You have the will.
Yep.
Mr. Washington changed my life. Young man, go to board and work this problem out. I can't, sir. Why not? I'm not one of his students. Look at me. Yes, sir. Go to the board and work the problem out anyhow. The other students started laughing. He's Leslie. He's got a twin brother, Wesley. Wesley's smart. He's DT. What's DT? He's the dumb twin. I am, sir. He came from behind his desk and looked at me. He said, don't you ever say that again. Someone's opinion of you does not have to become your reality. He looked at you with the eyes of girth. He said, look at a man the way that he is, he only becomes worse. But look at him as if he were what he could be, then he becomes what he should be. He looked at me, and when he spoke those words, he interrupted the story I believed about myself. That's why we're told, be ye not conformed to this world, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. When he looked at me, and I looked in his eyes, he looked at me like I was somebody. He didn't label me. I don't believe we should label kids. They should label jars, not children. What do you want to do with your life, young man? I want to become a disc jockey, sir. I want to buy my mother a home. He said, you got to be hungry. Let us say together, you got to be hungry. I said, what do you mean by that? He said, people that are hungry are willing to do the things today others won't do in order to have the things tomorrow others won't have. People that are hungry are relentless. People that are hungry are unstoppable. People that are hungry believe always strive to get on top in life because it's the bottom that's overcrowded. People that are hungry believe that you will fail your way to success. People that are hungry won't take no as an answer. People that are hungry believe in zero excuses. They focus on results. People that are hungry take no prisoners and eat the wounded. People that are hungry, a different breed. I'm hungry, sir, to take care of my mother. I'm hungry, sir, to people who people wrong about me. They've always said, I'm DT. I'm gonna say sticks and stones can break your bones and words can never hurt you, but it does hurt me, sir. That's why I'm in the dean's office of fighting. Mr. Brown, don't fight. What do you mean? Don't get angry, Mr. Brown. Why? Anger is a wind that blows out the lamp of the mind, young man. And how do I get even, sir? Mr. Brown, remember these words by Frank Sinatra. The best revenge is massive success. Focus on becoming massively successful. I say to you, you're going to have haters. I say to you, people are going to talk about you. They're going to criticize you. They're going to try and sabotage you. Why? I don't know. It doesn't matter why. I'm saying don't let them stop you. You're on a mission. You've got work to do. You've got to be hungry. When you're hungry, you're focused. Where focus goes, energy flows. And so I was hungry to become a disc jockey. He said, here, I want you to go in my car and listen to a guy named Paul Hobby. Why? He's the world's greatest communicator. You want to be successful? Find someone doing what you want to do. Watch them, study them, and learn from them. How many of you in here love speaking? Raise your hands, please. Very good. Write this down, lesbrown77@gmail.com. lesbrown77@gmail.com. Do it before 12 midnight. Text me and say, I'm hungry to speak. I'm hungry to tell my story. I'm hungry to make money with my story. lesbrown77@gmail.com. One of my staff members get back to you. And so I listen to Paul Hobby. And then Mr. Washington told me to go to WMBM radio station on Miami Beach and meet with Milton Butterball Smith, the program director, and tell him I sent you to him. I said, yes, sir. I went to WMBM. Hello, sir. My name is Les Brown, sir. I like to be a disc jockey. Young man, do you have any experience? No, sir, no. Let me audition for you, sir. Let me show you how good I am. You have any experience at all in broadcasting? No, sir, I don't, but I'm good, sir. I visualize myself being on the radio talking. I practice every day. He said, I'm sorry, we don't have any job. I was devastated with rejection. How many of you have been rejected? Raise your hands, please. I went back and I said, Mr. Washington, they said no. He said, don't take it personally. Most people are so negative they have to say no seven times before they say yes. He said, you gotta be hungry. Go back again. Yes, sir. I went back again. Hello, Mr. Butterball. How are you, sir? My name is Les Brown, sir. I like to be a DJ. Weren't you here yesterday? Yes, sir, I was. Did I tell you no yesterday? Yes, sir, you did. Then why are you back today? Well, sir, I didn't know whether or not somebody was laid off or somebody was fired. No, sir, nobody was laid off or fired. Now get on out of here. I came back the next day, talking loud, looking happy, like I'm seeing you for the first time. Hello, Mr. Butterball. How are you, sir? My name is Les Ross, and I like to be a DJ. I know what your name is. Weren't you here the last 2 days? Yes, sir, I was. Didn't I tell you no the last 2 days? Yes, sir, you did. Then why are you back today? Well, sir, I didn't know whether or not someone got sick or someone died, sir. No one got sick or died. No one was laid off or fired. Now, don't you come back here again. I came back the next day, talking loud, looking happy, like I've seen him for the first time. He said, hello, Mr. Butterball, how are you? He looked at me with rage. He said, go get me some coffee. I said, yes, sir. My favorite book says, the greatest among you will be your servant. How many of you have a job? Raise your hands, please. Fantastic. Write this down. Provide more service than you get paid for. Provide more service than you get paid for. It's not for them, it's for you. Hold yourself to establishing the habit of giving your best at all times, under all circumstances. A lady became the dominant force in her industry, and some news reporters asked her, how did you get here? And she said, it's not our intention to please our customers or to satisfy our customers. Our intention is to amaze them with our service. How many of you want to amaze the people that you serve? Raise your hands, please. That's what the requirements are in making it in this global economy. Average is not an option. And so I became an errand boy for the disc jockeys. Write this down. Give before you ask. Yes, I volunteered. They didn't pay me. I volunteered. I go get their lunch and their dinner, and I stand in the control room watching them move their hands on the control board, knowing my time would come. Let us say together, I expect to win.
I expect to win.
I want you to write that down. I expect to win. When you write something down, it engages the subconscious mind. I write that down when I have a goal 7 times. I expect to win. I expect to win. I expect to win. That will activate that reticular activating system. It's a network like Google cells at the base of your brain. that stimulates your level of awareness. You'll be amazed. You'll start seeing things you were not able to see before. I expect the wind. You'll become a magnet for the people, the things, the resources, and the money you need to make your dream become a reality. And so, I became the person that they can count on, the go-to person. I want to establish a reputation that I can be counted on to make things happen. And then one day, I went outside and I waxed the guys' cars and cleaned them inside out. Nobody asked me to do it. They came out and said, "Hey, who did this?" "I did, sir." "How much you charge, young boy?" "Oh, nothing, sir. I'm just trying to help out." Write this down. Build relationships. People don't want to be treated like transactions. They want a relationship. You want to provide more service and you get paid for it. You want to learn their name and refer to them by their name. You want to find out all the different things that you can do to build and strengthen that relationship because you want a long-term relationship with that person. Repeat business and referral business. I have a friend named Brian Buffini. He's in the real estate business, and he always says to his clients, after he closes a sale, "We're always available and never too busy for referrals." He asks for them, and he gets them, and has built a multi-million dollar business. He's written a book called The Immigrant Edge. And so, one day, a Saturday afternoon, I was asked to drive one of the DJ's Cadillac on Miami Beach to pick up at the airport Diana Ross and Supremes, the Four Tops and the Temptations. I was driving them all over Miami Beach in the disc jockey's big long Cadillacs. I didn't have any driver's license, but I'll drive my ass. And this Saturday afternoon, I came back to the station. I was listening, and Rockin' Rodney was on the air. And when he would start talking about fried chicken, I knew he had too many drinks in. I went inside the station, and I was looking at him. And I was the only one there. He began to slur his words. And was so drunk, he was about to fall off the chair.
Drink, rock, drink.
And I was looking at him, saying, "Drink, rock, drink. Drink, rock, I'm going to get you more if you ask me. Drink, rock, I'm right here with you. Drink, rock." And pretty soon the phone rang. It was the general manager, and answered the phone. I said, "Hello?" He said, "Young boy, this is Mr. Klein." I said, "I know." He said, "Rock can't finish his program." I said, "I know." He said, "Could you call one of the other DJs in?" I said, "Yes, sir." I hung the phone up and said, "Now he must be good, I'm crazy." I called my mom and my girlfriend, Cassandra. I said, "Y'all come out on the front porch and turn on the radio. I'm about to come on there." I waited for about 20 minutes and I called him back. I said, "Mr. Klein, I can't find nobody." He said, "Young boy, you know how to work the controls?" I said, "Yes, sir." He said, "Go in there, don't you say nothing here." I said, "Yes, sir." I couldn't wait to get old Rock out of the way. I put on a fast record. I said, "Look out, this is me, LB Triple P. Let's crown your final playing papa. There were none before me, and there will be none after me. Therefore, that makes me the one and only. Young and single, love to mingle. Certified, bonafide, you will be qualified to bring you satisfaction and a whole lot of action. Look out, baby, I'm the young man. Always trying to get on top of life. Because it's the bottom that's on the top. Yes, sir. People that are hungry, you are here because you're hungry. There's something in you. Something in you that just won't let you rest and live a mediocre life. Something in you that says the best is yet. There's something in you. says, I'm not going to allow these adverse circumstances to get the best of me. There's something in you that says I'm self-definition. The things I've gone through, the mistakes that I've made, they don't define me. There's something in you that refuses, a hunger that refuses to be denied. Some people call it a magnificent obsession. Hunger. Paul Robeson said, here I stand, for I can do no other. President Barack Obama called it the audacity of hope. Hunger. Dr. King called it a dream, that hunger. Nelson Mandela gave up 26 years of his life of a hunger to break the back of apartheid, and he succeeded. Hunger. Miles Monroe traveled around the world saying to people, the worst thing in life is not dying. The worst thing in life is dying without purpose.
Yeah.
Hunger. I don't know what you're going to do. But here's what I know about you. You have greatness in you. You have greatness in you. You know it. You believe as I believe. The best is yet to come. You believe as I believe. God is not through with you yet. You believe as I believe. There's something in you that the mind does not understand. It doesn't make sense. But you now, I'm not going to argue with your mind. You're going to live from your heart, because where your heart is, there your treasure is also. And I believe this with you. If you believe as I believe, I'd like you to join me. I'm looking for voices of hope. People who want to make a difference with their story, who believe that they can build a business transforming lives with their voice and can build a legacy. If you believe as I believe, I encourage you to join me and email me lesbrower77@gmail.com. I'd like to thank Alicia and Andrew and all of her team for making this event possible. All of our media partners that were so kind to allow me to come on their show to be interviewed. Thank you. I want to thank all of you. How loving and gracious you have been. And if you see somebody look at me, look like me, and he starts running. And he smells of curry chicken, it's probably my father. He's behind on his child support payment, and that's why he's running. We think you're going to turn him in and tell him it's okay, I'm fine. I'd like to leave this with you. I don't know what your goals are. And thank you for blessing me with your presence and being so kind to my son, Patrick. I don't know what you want to do, but here's what I know about you based upon my own experience. That you have something special. You have greatness in you. And I'd like to leave this with you that I'm known by. My mother loved it. Leslie, yes, ma'am, mama. Say that thing for me, boy, that makes me feel good. Yes, ma'am, mama. Everybody put your hand over your heart. And listen to me. That dream is in your heart. That heartbeat that you feel. That heartbeat, you were chosen. Life is God's gift to us. And how we live our lives is our gift to God. That heartbeat that you feel right now, you were chosen by God to do a greater work. And so I'd like to leave this with you. If you want a thing bad enough to go out and fight for it, to work day and night for it, to give up your time, your peace, and your sleep for it, if all that you dream and scheme is about it, life seems useless and worthless without it, and if you gladly sweat for it and fret for it and plan for it and lose all your terror of the opposition for it, and if you simply go after that thing that you want with all of your capacity, strength and sagacity, faith, hope, and confidence, and stern pertinacity. If neither cold poverty, famine shall go, sickness of pain of body and brain can keep you away from the thing that you want, if dogged and grim you besiege and beset it, with the help of God, you will get it. You have something special.
Amen.
You have greatness in you. This has been Mrs. Mamie Brown's baby boy, and Jamaica's pride and joy. God bless you.